good.
In 1995, he started China's first internet company. I decided to join his revolution and saw behind the scenes of a rising China.
That was a clip from Crocodile in the Yangtze, a documentary charting the rise of Chinese e-commerce giant Alibaba. Its founder, Jack Ma, is now believed to have a net worth of $2.7 billion. Alibaba says by next year its sales will surpass Amazon and eBay's combined. The filmmaker behind Crocodile in the Yangtze is Porter Arisman, a Canadian who worked for Alibaba from its time as a startup to its time as a billion-dollar company. I spoke with him earlier and started by asking him how his story stands out when compared to other internet startup stories like The Social Network.
This is really a story about a startup company. And I think what's unique about it, it's a documentary that captures the growth of a company from an apartment all the way into a global company with 16,000 employees. It just happens to be in China, which is pretty rare because it's difficult to get that kind of access to behind-the-scenes footage in China. But after I left the company I was working for, Alibaba, I wanted to tell this story. I thought it was an inspiring one that entrepreneurs could learn from. So I made my film to really show this startup to a big company growth phase, but also to describe some of the tactics that were used by Alibaba Group when they battled eBay in China.
So let's talk about what we can learn from Alibaba. It is a Chinese company. It's operating in a huge market. Was it difficult to get an internet company started in that market, first of all? Because we know that with the Chinese government, there are some restrictions of what you can and can't do. Was that a big hurdle?
Well, it's interesting because most Westerners think that the internet is strictly controlled in all areas in China. Of course, that's really true in certain domains, but in e-commerce, it's something that the government has really encouraged, which is partly why there are about 500 million internet users in China. So long as Alibaba Group was focused on e-commerce and helping small businesses start businesses online, they really encountered no problems. It was only when Alibaba did a deal with Yahoo that some of the political issues came to the fore.
And let's talk about this, the kind of underdog status that Alibaba had against eBay. You know, you think, well, China is this massive country. Obviously, even domestically, you could wind up with a company of huge clout. But in the beginning, did it feel like a really uphill battle?
Yeah, it's interesting. When I joined Alibaba in 2000, the company had just moved out of a small apartment. And I think even I had underestimated my colleagues. It was just a ragtag team of English teachers, journalists, dreamers who basically had this idea of starting a global internet company. And so I watched over time as my colleagues grew and developed over time. And I think they surprised me first, but then when we had a battle with eBay, it really surprised eBay because eBay came into China with their US model, assuming they could put it right on the China market and succeed. But actually, they sort of failed the business 101 lesson, which is you always have to adapt your business and your services to the local customers. So that's why I think Alibaba ultimately prevailed over eBay in China.
What are some of the key differences in terms of the failure of eBay to adapt? What would you identify as the biggest differences?
Well, I think the problem with eBay's model for China was that eBay kept the buyers and sellers blind from each other. But in China, trust is a really big issue. It's still e-commerce is still in its infancy. So one of the things that Alibaba did was it integrated chat software into their marketplace, which allowed the buyers and sellers to build friendships and build up their relationships so that they could establish the trust needed to do transactions online. I think adding that human touch was really the big difference, and that eBay, its model may work in North America, but not so well in China.
You worked closely with Jack Ma, the founder. Where do you see this, him taking this company? I mean, how big can Alibaba get globally?
Well, he's a guy who is a big dreamer. He has a lot of ambition. I think he measures his own success by the impact he has on society. You know, people obviously in the West know Steve Jobs or Mark Zuckerberg. He's of that same sort of vein. And I think Alibaba can and should be the biggest e-commerce company in the world. Already, I just recently read that the company's predicting that its sales transactions will surpass eBay and Amazon combined. It's only natural that the world's most populous country should have the world's largest e-commerce company. And as long as they execute well, stick to their values, I think they're in a good position to do that.
You know, there's a lot of debate now, as you know, in North America about fears around Chinese investment, around Chinese companies, telecom equipment companies, perhaps engaging in espionage. What do you make of that sort of sense of fear of this great giant country on our doorstep?
Well, one of the reasons I made the film is to really show that the things that China and the West have in common are really supersede any big differences. I think a lot of times the media tends to play them up in black and white terms. So I wanted to shed some light on the nuances of some of the conflicts that arise when China and the West come head to head. Having said that, I do think there are cases where it makes sense for the U.S. and China not to cooperate. There's different value systems, different political systems. And so I know with some of these recent efforts by some Chinese technology companies to come into the U.S., you know, I think that government should take a close look at it. When it comes to e-commerce or something that's more politically neutral, there's more room for mutual benefit than conflict. So I think there are certain areas where cooperation makes sense and others where conflicts are inevitable.
All right. We got to leave it there, Porter. We appreciate your time today.
Great. Thanks for having me.
Porter Arisman is director of the film Crocodile in the Yangtze.